Today we're going to talk about violence coming from the sewer pipe of Hollywood. We are going to continue talking about the violence and pornography that is spewing out of the sewer pipe of Hollywood to the world, which has triggered the Islamic revolution around the globe. I don't care what anyone says. I don't care what anyone says. It's a reaction to the sewer pipe of Hollywood. You could say it's our foreign policy with regard to Israel, but it doesn't explain the Islamic violence in Indonesia. It doesn't explain the Islamic violence in all of those other hot points around the world. No, it doesn't. You can blame the Jews all you want, but I'm going to say that most of the Islamic hatred for the West is not about Christianity per se. It's about the culture. What do you mean the culture? The pornography and the violence that is being created, disseminated through the sewer pipe of Hollywood. And so I want to talk again today about this issue because somebody has to knock their heads together. Somebody has to take Katzenberg, Ratzenberger, and bang their heads together and say, the party is over, Bubala. It's time for you to understand that the world is not going to take your vile garbage anymore. I don't care if you created the presidency. You're not gods. You're not Caesars. So I'm going to read for you the Motion Picture Production Code, which was the industry moral censorship guidelines that governed the production of most U.S. pictures released by major studios between 1930 and 1968. It was known as the Hays Code, named after Hollywood's chief censor of the time, Will H. Hays. And so people followed this code. I told you I grew up in a time when my father said certain things were never allowed to be shown in movies, but you don't know why. Well, there was a code. And that code was thrown out around the same time that Allen Ginsberg, William Kunstler, and other of the most despicable human beings appeared on the planet, meaning on the social scene. 1968, when marijuana made its way into the mainstream, and when left-wing fanaticism threatened to tear down civilization itself, they tore down any restraints upon Hollywood, and the rest is history. The production code spelled out what was acceptable and what was unacceptable. Content for motion pictures produced for public audience in the U.S. So what was not allowed to appear in movies? What was not allowed to appear in movies up until 1968 when William Kunstler, Allen Ginsberg, I can name a few others who destroyed Western civilization, shook the pillars of civilization and almost destroyed us. I don't know that we've survived, frankly. Among the things that were not allowed to appear in movies, you're listening to The Savage Nation, were the following. Pointed profanity, suggestive nudity, the illegal traffic in drugs, children's sex organs, ridicule of the clergy. Let's pause right there. Do you know of one movie that's called a drama today or action that does not have profanity, nudity, drugs, children half naked, or a ridicule of the Catholic Church? I don't know of one. Ask Katzenberg, Matzenberg, and Ratzenberg. Why they continue to make such vile filth. Let me go on. Among the things that required special care, according to the Motion Picture Production Code, when dealt with in the movies were the following. The use of the American flag. Jeffrey, the use of the American flag, the thing that has given you your fame and fortune, Mr. Katzenberg, the thing that you spit upon, in my opinion. Arson, the use of firearms, theft, robbery, safe-cracking, dynamiting of trains, mines, and buildings. Couldn't show them in the movies. Brutality and possible gruesomeness. Ha! Oh, Marty Scorsese, where would you be without this? Martin Scorsese, the great genius, old Marty. Everyone refers to him as Marty on a first name basis because he's such a nice guy. Or Robert De Niro or Sean Penn. Nice liberals. They're all psychotic left-wingers, aren't they? So let me interject this. Which actors and directors, aside from Sean Penn, in your opinion, are most guilty of violence, which they then cover up with their excessive liberalism? It's an old game. You make your living showing extreme violence. You make your fortune that way, and then you pretend you're a liberal. You go to Haiti and you, I don't know what you do in Haiti. I have no idea what he did down there. No one does. Or you towed a machine gun in Louisiana after the Hurricane Katrina to show you're a tough guy in life as you are in the movies. So which actors, aside from the despicable Sean Penn, in your opinion, are most guilty of violence, which they then cover up with their extreme liberalism? So let me go on now with the other things that required special care when dealt with in movies while Katzenberg, Matzenberg, and Ratzenberg were still wild-eyed, woolly-eyed hippies. and not yet making movies. The use of the American flag, arson, the use of firearms, theft, robbery, safe cracking, dynamiting of trains, mines, buildings, brutality, gruesomeness. Technique of committing murder, Jeffrey, by whatever method. Technique of committing murder, Mr. Spielberg. Sympathy for criminals, Mr. Spielberg. Sedition, Mr. Scorsese, Spielberg, Katzenberg, Katzenberg, Ratzenberg. Apparent cruelty to children and animals. The sale of women or of a woman selling her virtue. A woman selling her virtue. A woman selling her virtue. Don't they all do it? Can you name one Hollywood slut who's actually married, who's had a baby in the last year? I love, they're a mom. Don't you love they're a mom? Don't you love that they're all moms walking around with their baby now, like the baby with odd names, no American names, of course. Names such as Hermes or scarf or handbag. Or shoe, or nail polish. Here's my little daughter named Nail Polish. Here's my other baby named Diamond Ring. Here is my baby named Gucci. Here is my baby named Poochie. Wait until Poochie becomes a man. You'll really see something. No husbands, but they're all moms. Suddenly they want to cash in on the image of mom and apple pie. You couldn't show rape or attempted rape. Or you could do it, but you had to do it in a special way. Deliberate seduction of girls, Jeffrey. The institution of marriage could not be assailed and ridiculed, Jeffrey. The use of drugs, Alec. Titles or scenes having to do with law enforcement or law enforcing officers. You had to treat them delicately. You couldn't turn every cop into a criminal and every degenerate bum into a hero, Jeffrey. I've just read to you the Motion Picture Production Code. That was a set of standards all followed by the major studios between 1930 and 1968. Tell me what the standards are today. Tell me what the standards are today. Or call me with which actors other than the despicable fraud, Sean Penn, in your opinion, are most guilty of violence, which they then try to cover up with extreme fraudulent liberalism. When I come back, I'm going to take your calls on the Savage Nation. I'm going to take your calls on those who are going to walk the wall of shame. We're going to have the wall of shame today of actors, directors, and others, even the men behind the scenes who have destroyed America's psyche and who have triggered the Islamic revolution around the world. I'll be right back.
Savage.
Don't want. Yes, the Savage Nation. We're talking about the destruction of civilization led by the movie industry, which until 1968 followed a motion picture production code. All thrown out with the arrival on the scene of the hippie gangsters, the LSD, the marijuana, led to the destruction of the movie, the self-control over the movie industry. I read to you the things that were not allowed to appear in movies. You probably don't believe me, but that's true. And I'll read it to you again later because nobody in the radio business actually gives you a lesson like I give you when I really want to get into it. Why did they break down all of the barriers of Western civilization? Because of a few people, Timothy Leary, Allen Ginsberg, Bella Abzug, and William Kunstler, in my opinion, were the horsemen of the apocalypse. There were others, but they tore down the law, the university, medicine, and literature. They tore it apart, and they opened the society up to the opportunistic infections that we are currently still fighting. And I don't think we can ever win them, because they're too powerful right now. The forces against civilization are too strong in our society. When you have the ACLU going after war memorial crosses, go to my website and see what they're doing now, those disgusting anti-American vermin. Here's a few simple, scared, cockamamie coward lawyers with law degrees in the ACLU telling war heroes and their descendants they have to tear down a cross in San Diego that's a memorial to soldiers from the Korean War. And they don't go over there and say, I'll tell you what, over my dead body. Come on, Marvin. Come on, Marvin. See if you can beat me up with your law degree. Come on, Marvin, see how tough you are. Go tear down the cross to my father's name. I don't know why the Christians take it. My website's very clear. I don't mean not going to hold back even more today or tomorrow. And as long as the Lord gives me the breath, I am telling you, you don't have to take it from those rats with law degrees. Who are they? Who made them a branch of government? And my headline's very clear. Christians, exclamation point, the ACLU hates you. Very clear. I don't give a parsed headline like Bill O'Reilly. Bill O'Reilly's headline today on the Fox website, new poll has President Obama up big. I would say shame on you, Bill, but a long time ago I realized you have no shame. You know that that's a lie, Bill O'Reilly. What do you mean President Obama up big? Every poll shows him down. But not Bill O'Reilly's poll. He conducted it in his toilet with his dog last night, and he found out that Obama's up big in his poll, in the O'Reilly poll. That way you can get him on the show. What? You talk about degeneracy here. You talk about pornography. A headline like that from O'Reilly is pornographic in its lie. But let me get back to the issue of the day, which is the Motion Picture Production Code and who destroyed us and which actors, aside from Sean Penn, are the most guilty of the violence, which they then try to cover up with liberalism. And you could throw in some directors, too, like Marty Scorsese, the god of Hollywood. Here are the 20 most violent movies, according to a blogger. He lists The Wild Bunch, which I don't think it is. 2, Switchblade Bromance, Reservoir Dogs, Quentin Tarantino, Battle Royale, Kokushan Takami's movie, Natural Born Killers, I don't know who did that, but Woody Harrelson, one of the most despicable men in the history of American cinema. At the time he was, he's nothing anymore, apparently. Another Oliver Stoner. 300, the movie, Hostel, which is one of the worst movies ever made, which is all about slashed ankles, dismemberment, electrocution, train crushing, you name it. Hostel has it. Cannibal Holocaust. This movie was so shocking in 1980 that the director Ruggero Deodato was arrested in Italy and charged with making a snuff film. The movie Cannibal Holocaust was banned in the UK for its scandalous depictions of violence. 7 real animals were butchered during the making of the film. Number 9, most violent film, Training Day, Denzel Washington. 10, Saving Private Ryan. I wouldn't put Saving Private Ryan on the list, and I'll tell you why. Yes, there's a lot of violence of soldiers being killed, but it's not gratuitous violence in that it is part of the story of World War II and of all war, for that matter. The others are just gratuitously violent. You see, there's a difference that I would expect people to understand. Number 11, Kill Bill, garbage. Quentin Tarantino, garbage, total garbage. The True Romance, never heard of it. I Spit on Your Grave, 1970. The Godfather, Francis Ford Mortadella. 16, Ed Gein, the movie about the true story of serial killer Ed Gein. It's about a serial killer. Scarface, number 1982, the remake of Howard Hawks' 1932 crime drama. You know, Tony Montana, Al Pacino becomes a drug kingpin in 1980s Miami. And there is a lot of violence in it, including an inventive helicopter assassination. A Clockwork Orange. Now, this is an interesting story as a violent movie. And what it meant, 1971, if you never saw it, don't. It's terrible. Stanley Kubrick's stylish treatise on morality and psychology, the violence. Championing a new shocking vein of ultraviolence, A Clockwork Orange pushed boundaries with its depictions of rape, gang crime, and psychological torture. Martyrs, 2008, French horror film. Gory, horrible. Apocalypse Now, post-Godfather epic is kind of it's violent, but the fact of the matter is, even though it's a bloodbath, I wouldn't put it into one of the most violent movies. So if you want to add to that list, name other violent movies where violence is gratuitous, be my guest. Why? We're doing the Hall of Shame now on the Savage Nation. The Hall of Shame of actors and directors, and studios for that matter, who not should be ashamed of themselves, but should be controlled by the federal government. You heard me. I'll say it again. That is right. That is right. Between 1930 and 1968, we had a motion picture production code. You know what the code is now? Whatever is more vile sells to the czars of Hollywood. When they come back from their yachts in the Med or the Caribbean, they sit there with their feet up on the desk and they look at someone who comes in, and if it's about someone who loves America or a soldier who gave his life for America. Get him out of here. Don't even let him in the door. What's he doing here? Get him out of here. We don't do movies about America. Get out of here. Oh, a movie about raping a 3-year-old. Now, wait a minute. Can we get away with that? Bring the lawyers in. How can we rape a 3-year-old on screen and get it? Can we get it in the theater? Can we get in there, rape of a 3-year-old, you think? Huh? Any way to get it in there?
Savage.
On the air, I called for Jingle Bell Rock to lighten it up. My inner sensor said you better back them off, because everyone's putting on their body armor and they're strapping on the body armor. They're putting on the drum mag, painting their faces. life is good, people are wonderful, and business is great. I remember those. Remember those bumper stickers in the 70s? Where did they ever go? Every car in California had another saying. It was grating. Well, it was innocent compared to today. If I see another Obama bumper sticker in Marin, I may have to go get a T-38 tank to drive on Highway 101. If I'm cut off by one more Prius driver from the right lane with an Obama sticker, I may have to buy an M1A Abrams if they're road ready, if they make them with rubber tires. Whoa. So what do you want to talk about? I mean, I've given you the motion picture production code in the Savage Nation. I've read you the list of the 20 most violent movies. I've laid the blame clearly at the feet where it belongs. I've asked Obama to stop blaming gun owners and start blaming movie makers. And I'm asking you, who other than Sean Penn, in your opinion, are most guilty of violence for their careers, which they then try to cover up with extreme liberalism? Period. It's simple. John in New York on WOR, you're the first up. Go ahead, please.
Well, you know, I'd say Woody Allen is subtly chipping away with his neurotic relationships, constantly love triangle. And when you span the whole of his career, the 30 years of love triangles, of this guy in love with that girl, in love with that guy, and no one's able to commit, it's like a little atomic bomb. Even though he sprinkles it well with a joke here and a joke there, it just literally attacks
Woody Allen made the weakling acceptable. Woody Allen made it acceptable for a white male to be a weakling and a kind of uncommitted weakling white male. Everyone thought it was cute to be like that. And one of the things he did specialize in is attacking the institution of marriage, but not solely that. He certainly went after everything else, mainly Jews. You know, he's Jewish, of course, but one of his favorite targets, notice, in the sense that they practice the religion and believe it. And that's why he always mocked them. Remember the famous scene in one of his movies where he is at a dinner somewhere, I don't know, in Annie Hall, and he's sitting at the table with the Christian people, and the grandmother stares at him, and in his inner mind, he thinks she sees him in a black hat, black garb with red hair and red whiskers and red sideburns. Remember that movie?
Yes.
All right, so why do you think Woody Allen was obsessed with attacking Orthodox Jews and running down Judaism? For the same reason he attacked marriage. So, yeah, he's a product of the 60s, and he's done very well at it. Who flies an F-22 Raptor. They don't want to see an Israeli who can be a battalion tank commander. They don't want to see an Israeli who stereotype. I'm going to go back again to the 1940s. There was a character called Step and Fetch It. He was the servile black actor. He made a fortune. What happened was black people had said, enough, we don't want that role anymore. So Hollywood stopped making it. They were afraid of the usual suspects with bullhorns. But no one has ever stood up and stopped making sick of it. Okay? Why? Why hasn't anyone said, cut it out, we don't like it? Or the drunk Irishman. You follow me?
Yeah.
You've yet to see an Islamic terrorist shown in a major movie that I've seen, maybe once in a while, 10 years ago. Why do they avoid showing any connection between terrorism, mayhem, roadside bombs, 9/11? Why have they never made a movie called 9/11? Tell me why. Tell me why Katzenberg, Hatzenberg, Matzenberg, and Ratzenberg, the big brave men of Hollywood, who produced the sewage that the world is vomiting back, how come they never made a movie called 9/11?
Yeah, you got a good...
They specialize in violence. It would fill a theater. Why won't they make that movie? Well, there's a number of reasons. One, because they're looking at international sales. Number two, a lot of their money comes from Saudi Arabians who would never fund such a movie. Go down the list. Go down the list. Why has my novel, Abuse of Power, with Jack Hatfield, who fights Islamic terrorism to save San Francisco, why is that not yet a major motion picture? It's a fabulous book. 6 weeks on the New York Times list or more. Why has it never been picked up by Hollywood? Because Katzenberg, Hatzenberg, Matzenberg, Ratzenberg, and Spielberg gave it a Caesar thumbs down. Expose the villains who have tried to destroy me, number one. And then I may do things that I had to put on hold while my life was destroyed by the people who live off me to try to destroy me. And I'm not naming names. I'm never going to name names. But you're going to find out what I lived through. And if you know anyone who could live through what I lived through at my age, I'll tell you what, I'll give them an award. I'll give them a Bronze Star in America. Nobody could live through what people who I thought were my allies and friends are trying to stick a knife in my back and trying to steal everything I earned my whole life. You would never believe it. You would never believe that I've been able to get up and do a radio show every day despite this. You would never believe the system. You'll never believe how distorted and perverted a certain legal systems. I'm doing a book with my lawyer on the perverted legal system and how people get destroyed by it. I even got a title. We got the pages written, laid out. You're not going to believe this book. Because I'm going to expose things that you've never heard that go on inside courtroom systems, and I'm going to name names. And it's going to be a worldwide blockbuster because everybody knows what the legal system does to them. Anyway, when I get through with that, I may make that movie. I may produce it. I may do other things. But thus far, 2 years of my life have been stolen. There is a God in heaven. Those who have done this to me, every last one of them falsely accusing me, should pay narration in advance. Okay? What do you want to talk about in the Savage Nation? I'll be right back.
Savage.
Well, now we change the pace and we go to The Godfather because we're talking about motion pictures and what they've done to society. We've named the villains. We named Leary Ginsburg, Abza Kunstler, who, in my opinion, kicked down the doors of Western civilization. And once that was achieved, the vermin in Hollywood went crazy. Profanity, nudity, drugs, children's sex, ridiculing the church, stepping on the flag, showing arson, overuse of guns, showing safe-cracking, robbery, theft, brutality of every kind, sympathy for murderers, sympathy for criminals, overt sedition, Oliver Stone in my opinion, a cruelty to children and animals, selling women, women selling their virtue, rape, constant rape, deliberate abduction of girls, destroying marriage, showing drug use, attacking law enforcement, cops, showing them all to be corrupt. This is what the vermin of Hollywood have done for the last 40 years. And as a result, now we see the shooting in the movie theaters, to me, is the end line of all of this. It should be the beginning of something new, but it won't be. You know it won't be. You're going to tell me Obama, their handpicked president, is going to do anything to them? No, he'll tell you to give up the AK-47. I say give up the HD camera. You may as well ban HD cameras as ban an AK-47. Tell Spielberg he can't use an HD camera anymore. Okay, let's go to the callers. Jack in Houston, you're up on the Savage Nation. What's on your mind?
Dr. Savage, you spoke about The Godfather. I'd like to compare that to the movie The Untouchables. And my point is that criminal or mob movies can be done in two different ways.
Right.
The Godfather was, I mean, like you said, just a nasty movie. But The Untouchables with Kevin Costner dealt with the mob, but you didn't see blood and gore. They didn't show the St. Valentine's Day Massacre.
Well, you know, but if you look back to The Godfather, by comparison today, it wasn't that violent. I mean, it seemed like comic book-like. You know, when you actually think about it, it was nothing compared to what the garbage that they put out today. You know, look, there's a lot of blame to go around. My main point today is that we need a new motion picture production code. That's my point. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I agree with that.
So that's the main point, is we need a new motion picture production code. And if they won't get their act together on their own, then the people have to get their act together. You say, well, they can. They don't have to go to the movies. That's easy to say. I've heard that before. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. That's like saying put drugs out there and let anyone who doesn't want to use it not use heroin. All right, does that make sense to you? Let heroin be legalized and let those who don't want to use it not use it, but it should be legal. I'm not ready for the Dutch method. I'm not ready for Dutch euthanasia, a nation that commits suicide. Holland committed suicide. So did you look at the whole, all the low countries have committed suicide. That's a kind of double entendre. But the fact is that the low countries have committed suicide, social suicide with their liberalism. Maybe that's why they were called low countries originally. Who knows? Look, this is not a funny topic. And I'm a movie lover. Don't think I'm like a Mennonite who sits in the house with a buggy whip. I don't sit at home, you know, and I ride my buggy to the studio. I love movies. But do I have to watch violence and pornography? No. I'll give an what's the blinking for? We're out of time again? Yes? Is it time for a break? What was the flash for? I don't know what the red... I thought it was your mistake. Watched the movie on television called War Winter or Winter War. War in the Winter. Never heard of it. Dutch movie. What was it about? A 13-year-old boy who starts, joins the underground resistance in Holland and helps them killing Nazis because they kill his father in this little town in Holland. It's one of the most stupendous sleepers I've ever seen. Was the violence gratuitous? No. Was there a lot of it? No. But it was the undertone was so, the drama was so profound that you felt tension from the entire movie. And you see some of the most beautiful scenery. It's wintertime in Holland during the Nazi occupation. It shows ordinary men and women joining the resistance to undermine the Nazis who have occupied this town. There's very little violence, but that which does occur literally makes your heart pound. Like when his father, the mayor, is taken out and put up against the wall with other men who stood up to the Nazis, or allegedly stood up, and they think they did, and he's standing before a firing squad, and this little 13-year-old kid is running, screaming to try and stop it. And as he jumps over the wall just before the guns go off, amazing movie. There's some amazing films out there, which of course have some violence, but there's a redemption to the violence. There's a meaning to the violence. And it's based upon reality. It's not just gratuitously thrown in there, like Kill Bill, for example, or something of that nature. And by the same token, the Saving Private Ryan is the same type of movie. Of course, there's violence in it. How many men were brutalized in World War II? There's violence in war. But to make it up? No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. And people would go to movies, by the way, which have redeeming value. The theaters would fill with movies such as that. It's not that such movies would not sell. I could make a movie. I could direct a movie about Madame Curie and make it into a bestseller. Do you know that? I could make a new movie about Madame Curie, a great scientist, and people would flock to it. Why? Because it's about a woman, when women were not prominent in science, who did the most amazing things in science and won a Nobel Prize. A lot of women would like that movie. Families would go to it. Why don't they make it? Because the mindset is in there. Matzenberg, and Spielberg don't even think that way. They don't think about values that lift people up. I used to leave movies in the 50s, come out as a little kid. I felt, do you remember going to the movies in those days before TV really, if anyone goes back, you'd come out of a movie in the middle of an afternoon. It looked strange. You didn't know what was real, the movie or the afternoon sun didn't look real to you. You'd come out in the daylight, everything looked wrong. Because you were just taken away into, okay, Audie Murphy, the hero, Audie Murphy, World War II, Korea, right? You wanted to be Audie Murphy, or you wanted to be John Wayne, or you wanted to be George Washington crossing the Delaware. You wanted to be someone who America loved. And we have many boys in this country who still do that. But they're not glorified. They're not lionized. They're laughed at by the vermin in Hollywood, as are the vermin in the ACLU trying to rip down the crosses that are erected in their honor. That's the society we're living in. It's like the fall of Rome. We're witnessing the collapse of Western civilization. And this, what went on in the movie theater, is almost a crescendo, but not the final crescendo by any means. It was almost a crescendo before the real crescendo of what's coming in this country. I fear another 9/11. When you have such numbskulls as Janet Napolitano in the Department of Homeland Security, when you have such pro-Islamic people running intelligence agencies, you're telling me we couldn't have another 9/11 in this country when they bend over backwards to see the side of Al-Qaeda? Yeah, you tell me about it. I don't sleep well at night. I fear another 9/11 in this country because I do not believe we have an intelligence apparatus that is able to do its job. By the way, 1-800-449-8255. Let's take the callers on the Savage Nation. Who do you think, aside from Sean Penn, in Hollywood is most guilty of using violence to advance themselves, which they then try to cover up with the superb false liberalism? Max in Las Vegas, you're up on the Savage Nation. Go ahead, please. Max, go ahead. You're on the Savage Nation. Shot, gone. Next, Monica Santa Maria, welcome to the Savage Nation. Go ahead, please.
Dr. Savage, I just want to simply say thank you from the bottom of my heart for being brave, having the courage to stand up and say these things. You're very brave, and thank you from the bottom of my heart.
You're welcome, and let me tell you something. I've paid a very high price. I've been boycotted. I've been ridiculed. I've been smeared. I've been ostracized. I've been outcast. I've been turned into an outcast. I'm living alone, basically. Society has rejected me. I'm banned from entering Britain and forth. And I said to him, something about, do you know I'm banned in Britain? He said, no, I know nothing about that. What does that tell you? Here is a guy who thought who's king about that. Why? Because all they know when they read about my name are a few things that I allegedly said that I never said. And for being crucified, I'm being crucified for things I never even said. I can't even enter Britain. Would you believe it? They let Islamic murderers live there. They let Islamic terrorists into England. They let them live off welfare. They're with 16 children. I can't enter Britain. Can you believe this? And this guy didn't even know it. This guy didn't even know it.
Disgusting.
And so, let me finish. My radio show is the number 3 in the country. Despite all of the boycotting, despite all of the blacklisting, my show is number 2 on the internet where there is no boycotting. See, all that has to be fed is by one station, and anyone can listen to it anywhere in the world. And so the show now is number 2 radio show on the internet. What does that tell you about the power of freedom and the power of the independent mind going against the establishment? I am actually the anti-establishment character that Martin Scorsese pretends to write about, produce movies about. See, this is something I really want to spend time on. All of these anti-heroes are really scum. The murderer is not an anti-hero. He's just a scum murderer. The drug dealer is not an anti-hero. He's a scum drug dealer. I'm the anti-hero. I'm the outsider. I'm the guy that everybody wants to actually be in Hollywood. I'm the guy that everyone in Hollywood who pretends to be a tough guy actually wishes they were. They couldn't walk in my shoes for 3 hours. None of them could do a 3-hour radio show ever. It's impossible. I'm telling you, they couldn't do it, but I'm actually the image that they're trying to project. I don't have to run around and strut around in Haiti after an earthquake. I don't have to strut around with a shotgun in Louisiana and then run to Hollywood and be a big stoner. Your hair will stand up. And you will say nobody on earth could live through what he lived through.
Savage.
Let's take your calls. 1-800-449-8255. Sean in Virginia, welcome to the Savage Nation. Go ahead, please.
Michael, you're absolutely right. When I was in the university in Europe in the mid-70s, our professor, who was fluent in Arabic and traveled the Middle East, he said, you don't understand how offended these folks are from your television, from your movies, from your music, how it's such an affront. They hate your culture and what you're doing to them. And it's not like they can protect their families because you can you can get those signals. When I lived in the Middle East, you could see Bedouins in tents out in the middle of the desert with a car battery and a television, and they're receiving signals like Baywatch and watching television that's broadcast from Europe or Israel, and they're seeing American TV out in the middle of the desert, and they can't keep their families from it, you know, and they just detest it. He predicted it.
Right, and so you agree with me that it's the sewage coming out of the sewer pipe of Hollywood that is wrecking the entire third world.
Absolutely. I lived for a year in the Middle East, and I've had young guys come up to me, you know, locals, and say, you know, that's what they hate.
Now, listen, I've alleged that it's the cultural pollution that has steamed up the entire Islamic world, and I've been they try to cover this up. You remember how powerful the movie industry is. Remember how powerful it is, and their allies in the banking industry. They've put out the propaganda that has nothing to do with our culture, nothing to do with our export of movies. It's something to do with Israel. They themselves are trying to blame Israel for all of the Islamic uprising, which is utter nonsense, because you can't explain 90% of the Islamic uprisings on Israel because they don't even know where Israel exists. Thank you for the call. And it reminds me of my own travels when I was doing the travels in the South Pacific. See, I went back to 1969, my first trips collecting plants in the South Pacific, in Fiji, Tonga, Samoa, etc. There was no television in Western Samoa when I had first gotten there. As the years went on, 1969, 70, 71, televisions were appearing in the Follies. Those are these straw houses in Western Samoa. And you would see entire groups of people sitting around a Folly at night instead of singing traditional songs. Sounds funny, doesn't it, Alec? Alec in Hollywood, you're laughing right now with your feet up. You think it's a joke, huh, what you've done to this world? Let me tell you something. Just as I sit here, there's a God in heaven, and one day you're going to be raked over hot coals for what you've done to this world. Not by me, certainly, but by the man upstairs. He knows what you've done. He knows what you've done. He sees the yacht. He's letting you have your fun with your G550, whatever, your yacht. You're having a good time. But it's a brief dance in the sun that you have right now, Alec. And when this dance in the sun is over and you go back from where you came, you're going to face your maker, and your maker's not going to be real happy with what you did during your brief dance in the sun here on the earth, Alec. So nevertheless, I sit in the villages where at night, maybe in the past, they would be singing songs or sitting talking, drinking Yangona. All of a sudden, they're sitting around a television in the middle of the straw hut being run by a generator watching, at that time, I don't know what it was, Dallas or something like that. And then sure enough, soon they were seeing other imagery, and in a few years, the boys of the villages were no longer obedient to their fathers and grandfathers. They were no longer following the law, the rules of their fathers. They were no longer following the rules of their society. Suddenly, they wanted to look like gangbangers in the ghetto. Suddenly, the boys in Western Samoa were aping the postures of the gangbangers in the ghetto. That's what happened to society. So how do you stop it? It's very simple. You say, oh, he's just, you know, venting. It's simple. Michael Savage says, bring back the motion picture production code that ended in 1968. Just as I said to you, bring back Glass-Steagall. And guess what? It's happening. Yeah, I wrote it in Trickle Up Poverty and Trickle Down Tyranny. Restore Glass-Steagall, which was thrown out by Bill Clinton and Rubin, who ran the Treasury Department. He came from Goldman Sachs to run the Treasury Department. He got rid of Glass-Steagall, where banks, commercial banks, and investment banks could merge and become one. The result was the disaster of 2008. Now they're saying they're going to restore the Glass-Steagall Act in part. It's under some new rule. I don't know what they're calling it. I am telling you that if we keep pushing back against the czars of Hollywood, we will have a motion picture production code, and we just might save America. It's a tough battle. It's tough and go, and I'm glad I'm on the front lines, and I'll be right back.
Savage.
We're talking about the vermin of Hollywood, the sewer pipe that comes out of Hollywood, and the czars of Hollywood, and the violence in the movie theater after the Colorado shooting. Here's a joke now. Harvey Weinstein calls for filmmaker summit on violence in movies after the Colorado shooting. I swear to God. Weinstein, produced some of the most violent garbage in the history of Hollywood. In fact, one could say he kicked down the doors of decency, and he's now probably the most powerful man in the world of a film. Weinstein, an avid Obama supporter, cites lack of gun control as the real culprit behind the Colorado theater. But old Weinstein says it's time for Hollywood to examine its part in perpetuating real-life events. Well, Harvey, I would say this, Harvey. We don't need gun control. We need Weinstein control. We need Spielberg control. We need Tarantino control. We need Scorsese control. You see, that's what we really need. We need Weinstein control. We need Tarantino control. We need Scorsese control. Do you think we'll ever get it? Of course not. They put Obama in office. So what will you think? Who's going to control him? Eric Holder? Eric Holder's going to control Hollywood when you have such nepotism going on in the Justice Department? From Godfather to The Dark Knight Rises, a history of violence in U.S. theaters. So he goes on, if we don't get gun control laws in this country, we're full of beans, says Weinstein, who needs to be Weinstein controlled. To have the National Rifle Association rule the United States is pathetic. Well, Harvey, I would say to have the ACLU rule the United States is even more pathetic. Then he goes on to quote his good friend Mayor Michael Bloomberg. Weinstein, who was throwing an Obama fundraiser on August 6th, goes on to say that he's backed all of Quentin Tarantino's violence-infused movies, the upcoming movies, A Violent Slave Era Western that's due out Christmas Day. That's what he's bringing to the world. A Violent Slave Era Western due out Christmas Day from the sterling mind of Weinstein. He also released Joel and Ethan Coen's No Country for Old Men, another fine film of quietude and peace. So he's put out this mayhem, and now suddenly he's acting like his skirts are clean. Here's what old Weinstein says. It's a question that I wrestle with all the time. I've been involved with violent movies, and then I've said at a certain point I can't take it anymore. Please cut it out. You know, you've got to respect the filmmaker, and it's a really tough issue. My heart goes out to those kids and those families, Weinstein said later in the interview. Oh, sure, Harvey. Was that between the sushi and the champagne? Sitting there feasting there in some restaurant? Your heart goes out to them. Ha, ha, hearty, har, har. As Jackie Gleason would have said. Harvey Weinstein, his heart goes out. Which heart, Harvey? Which heart is it? What heart? People in Hollywood say you have no heart. Harvey Weinstein calls for a filmmaker summit after violence in movies, after Colorado shooting, but he says it's time for gun control. No, it's time for Weinstein control. It's time for Tarantino control. It's time for... Well, you know, it's time for some controls, but you're never going to get them. Never in a million years. Never in a million years. I'll take your calls now on the Savage Nation. Gary in Sacramento on KSTE. Go ahead. You're on the show.
Michael, I want to thank you very much for bringing up this subject. I really do appreciate this. I've looked into the dead eyes of studio heads, directors, and producers when I worked in a major motion picture studio for 13 years as a struggling screenwriter. And I cannot express the amount of rage that I have with what's going on in Hollywood. I felt this way for the last 30 years. I got out of the business because I had enough of it. I lead a normal life now as a contractor. I'm not a screenwriter anymore, but I just couldn't take it anymore, Michael.
I know lawyers who've left the legal profession because they have to lie for a living. Many of them would rather work as a carpenter than as a lawyer.
That's right. I mean, these people make their living lying, cheating, stealing. It's nothing but the trickery and deception. And what I want people to do is to communicate with one another, tell other moviegoers how you feel about all of this, because that's what...
But look, let's be real. You think Harvey Weinstein is going to change his ways, a man who came from nothing and made such a fortune in this country by purveying pornography and violence, in my opinion? You think he's going to change his... You know, that's his stock and trade. It's like if you're a fishmonger and lox sells, pike and whitefish sells, but trout doesn't sell, you think he's going to start selling trout and angelfish?
He will never change, Michael.
He will never change. The government has to control Harvey Weinstein, Quentin Tarantino, and the others who have put out this garbage. It's never going to happen. What do you think that they put politicians like Obama in office for? It's for days like this. You think Obama's going to say it's the problem, it's a cause, the movies caused it? No, he goes after the gun owners, NRA. That's what he does. Thanks for the call. It's unbelievable.